We are very happy to have Diego Hueltes. He's a Python engineer working with big data and machine learning in Granada. And he'll be talking about genetic algorithms for improving scikit pipelines.
Thank you. Okay, thank you for coming. I know that Sunday after lunch, the yesterday social event was nice, so thank you for coming. Okay, data science for lazy people. Let's start. As always, a little about me. I'm Python engineer in Ravenpack. We work in Marbella. It's a beautiful city in the south of Spain. We are heading, by the way, so if somebody is interested, can contact me. Okay. I'm also a big data teacher in the executive program of big data in the Escuela Organización Industrial, that is a business school in Spain. And also I am a data science enthusiast. I have worked as data scientist in the past, but now I do in my free time as a hobby. Here you have some ways to contact me. Let's start. That's my cat. It's very lazy. Sleep around 20 hours a day. When do you think that he cannot sleep anymore? He stretch a little, like in the photo, and he continues sleeping. It's amazing. In my next life, I want to be like him. It's the perfect definition of lazy. 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 With following the Oxford Dictionary, is unwilling to work or use energy. This talk title is Data Science for Lazy People. You are here. So, just joking. But I'm proud of being lazy, but not lazy in that meaning. I would like to update that meaning. I'm unwilling to work or use energy in repetitive tasks. When I do the same more than two times, then I heard a voice in my head telling me, come on. You can do it better. Automate it. And yes, true. And then imagine the voice with my first cat, with my cat face. That's quite scary. Okay, that is the normal workflow that we follow when we do data modeling. We get the raw data. Then we do the data cleaning, the feature selection, feature preprocessing, feature construction. Then we choose a model, we optimize the parameter of this model, and then we validate the model. Yeah. Okay. We know that the data cleaning depends on the data, so it's something that cannot be automated. But this part here is something that sometimes we repeat some things. Yeah, we know that we can choose some parts, some preprocessors, some feature selectors, some way of construct the variables, some model family, some parameter optimization. Yeah, we know, but sometimes we repeat the things, and there are ways for avoiding that. It's the automated machine learning. There are some of them that they are doing interesting things. And I'm going to speak about the first one. It's TPOT. TPOT is a Python tool that automatically creates and optimizes machine learning pipelines using genetic programming. Here you have the URL. The author of that is Randy Olson. I don't know if you know him, but he writes really interesting posts and tweets and so. So I recommend following him. And also contribute in the open source, because it's open source, of course. Let's see the most important part of that. So we want to optimize machine learning pipelines. And we want to do using genetic programming. So machine learning pipelines, and in that case, scikit-learn pipelines. How many of you have used the scikit-learn pipelines? Yeah? Okay. Scikit-learn pipelines is just that piece of code that is something that we normally do. like we have here a feature extractor. So we apply that feature extractor over the data set, and then the train set and the test set. And when this transformed data set, we apply it in the model in that way, no? So that thing can be transformed to that other thing that is exactly the same, but we define a way of transforming the data and then apply the model. Okay, so seems quite similar, but it's really powerful because it's something that we can change programmatically. So that pipeline that can contain preprocessor, feature selectors, models, we can optimize, we can do in some programmatic way, we can do some changes to try to get the best pipeline. Okay? So, just a few notes. You can use some feature selector like that, or preprocessors, or classifier and regressors. And the good thing is, for instance, you can see here, we have the XGBoost. Yes, you can also use XGBoost in the pipelines. So we are going to optimize the best-in-class algorithms that we have for modeling. No, we are familiar with SQLN, so it's going to be easy. Okay, so we want to optimize that pipelines. And how we want to do it? We want to do it with genetic programming. How many of you know what is genetic programming? Yeah, perfect. Just in case of some of you think that genetic programming is that, I'm going to do a quick explanation of the basics about the genetic programming. That's a photo I took in last September, so I'm proud of it. That's a giraffe. That giraffe has long legs, long neck, and we know that that's because in Africa you can find that kind of trees that are tall trees. And also there are predators, so if you have a high position, you can see all of them. So it's more likely to survive if you are a tall animal, in that case, like the giraffe. But why the giraffe is tall? The giraffe is tall because two things, mutation and crossover. Crossover is when there are one giraffe with a long neck, another giraffe that has long legs. If they have a child, no, the next giraffe will have the best things, or will probably inherit the best part of the giraffe A and giraffe B. Okay, so that with that crossover, we are more likely to have tall giraffes. But then, who is the first giraffe with long neck? The first giraffe with long neck was because of a mutation. That is the second operation. That one day suddenly born a giraffe with a neck a bit longer. So that giraffe was more likely to reproduce than the other ones. So with these two operations, we can explain that giraffes have evolution in that way. Okay? So we can apply exactly the same, but with pipelines. Imagine that tree, a pipeline at the end is a tree, that we can score. So imagine that we are scoring that trees. So we have some trees like that three. Imagine that three are three ones that have a good score. We choose a random trees. Imagine that we can have a lot of feature selectors, preprocessors, model parameters, and so. So the combination of them is huge. So we take some random one, and we score it. At the end, we take the best one to do a crossover. That means we take some things from one parent, and we take other things from the other parent, and we generate two children. That child, for instance, has this part from one parent and that other for that other parent. Okay, that's the crossover, and the mutation is we pick a tree and randomly change one branch and say, okay, now you are going to have that. And then we measure if we have been lucky and we have something better than before. If we repeat that one time and again and again. At the end, we are going to find in a quick way the best solution, the optimal solution that we want to have in that case. That's something that if you want to play with genetic algorithms or know the basics of genetic algorithms, you can see the genetic walker is a funny tool when you can change the genetic the mutation rate, you can change the crossover rate, you can change some things and see who is going learning to walk, no? It's a kind of boxes that they know more or less how to walk, but depending how they move the arms and so. And it's quite hypnotic, and I recommend you to play a little with it. So let's start with TPOT. That's the way as we do an optimization with TPOT. We import from TPOT, and then we just say, okay, that is a TPOT classifier, fit this this data set. We don't have to do anything. Only with that is going to start to try pipelines using the genetic programming, and when it ends or you stop the iteration because probably you are tired to wait, then it will give you the best pipeline in that object. It's a sequence learned object, so you can use it to predict. You can do tpot.predict and it will work. Also, you can use in a from terminal in that way. You specify the data, you specify the where do you want to store the best pipeline, and after when that finish, you will get in that file the best pipeline, no? Or you can do it in that way. You will see it later. I thought it was there. Okay, about the parameters that we can use. Here you have an URL with a table where you can see all the parameters and the default ones. I'm showing here the init. I think it's the best way to see what we can do here. I encourage you to change the number of generation or population size. That will impact directly in the time that is going to be trying pipelines. Of course, as many generation and population size, it's more likely that you are going to find the best pipeline. But you can change other things like the offspring size, mutation rate or crossover rate, that is offspring size by default is the same of the population size. If you don't know what are you doing, if you don't know exactly what do you want to do, I recommend you to leave this parameter by default. One important thing to change is the scoring function. You can use some default ones like the accuracy, the mean square error. You have a list of error functions you can use, a score function, sorry, because it can be accuracy or error. Or you can use your own scoring function. Then, important, that CV is the fault that you want to apply in the crossover validation, because you want to pipeline not, you don't want to have overfitting. That is something that normally it's happening here. The other important thing you have to change, probably, is the config dict. This config dict is the way that you have to say, I want you to try these algorithms. I want you to try this preprocessor. I want you to try that model. So in that way, you are not just trying everything. You are just trying what you want to try. Also, you can use some default, like if you put a string like tpot light, it's going to use a small reduced number of preprocessors and so, or if you, by default, it has a big set that probably is enough to choose a optimal pipeline. And that is how it looks config dict. It's just to show you if you have the work sometimes with the grip search. It's something similar to that. So you just say, okay, I want you to use that function And that's all the parameters I want you to try. You give a list, okay? In that parameter, I want you to try true false. I want you to try that list of numbers. I want you to try what do you want, no? Okay. So let's see a basic example. That is the basic example. You can find the documentation. As you can see, I just changed the number of generations and population size. Some verbosity for having the right outputs. And I define the number of jobs 2-1. That means try all the cores of my laptop. That is a Mac, so. So at the end, you are going to see something like that, some progress. You see who is going 0.98, 98, 99 at the end, no? And at the end, you have this output that means, okay, that's the model, the pipeline I choose. And as I told you before, you can export in that way. tipo.export. That will, and a name of the file. That will create something like that. That is a Python script that in theory will take the CSV file and will predict the with using that exported pipeline. That's useful to take if you want to persist one model, because normally you can run that several times and it's going to be random. The output can be the difference, even if you are using the same parameters. Then you can say, okay, I think that pipeline is good enough, so I'm going to persist it. You can export in that way and just pick that for your notebook. Okay? So I wanted to try with the Titanic Kaggle competition. I suppose you know about that competition. It's the basic one in Kaggle. You can find in the tipot repository a Titanic example. It's not that. I wanted to show how is the usage of tipot without any data cleaning. Of course, the data cleaning is important. As more you clean your data, more likely to find the best solution is it. So as you can see here, I'm doing zero data cleaning. I just doing the label encoding of that column because are string columns. And for trees, that unfortunately is not something good. So you can see it's really, really zero data cleaning. So 3 lines of code, 2 really. Tipot classifier, fit that data set. Okay, with population size 50, verbosity of 2. Five generation, population size 50. So at the end, we will have this exported pipeline, or I had this exported pipeline. Probably if you run it again, you are going to have other different one, can be. And at the end, it scored 0.83. Uploading that to the Titanic competition, it had 0.88 at the end, okay? Have some kind of overfitting, but it's in the first 2,000 submits in the Titanic competition. We are it's 2 lines of code. We did zero data cleaning. We just try to see something random, and we are in the first 2,000 of 7,000 something submits. So that's great. It's something that we can use to give some hints about what we can do with the data. Okay? I did exactly the same to try the regressor. It's the house price, other car competition. Exactly the same, but that time I was even last year, and I say, okay, if the column type is object, just label it, and I don't want to know the name of the columns. I did the same, and that's important. This time I used a custom function, because you can see here, in the Titanic example, I'm using scoring accuracy. But no, I define a function that is the runmen square error log, that is the one that Kaggle used, and it's not in the default ones. is not in the list of that you can use. So yes, it's okay. I can define the function. And something important is to know that if it's an error function, if your scoring function is an error function, you have to use the word error in the name, in the function name. Because if that way you are going to try to minimize that function. If you don't specify, it's going to try to maximize the function. So that's important. So I did exactly the same, but that time, and even with 50 population size, 50, 5 generations, and this error function, I have this pipeline that is using a combination of 3 regressors. So at the end, it was in the first 900 of 2000 something submits, and again, 3 lines of code. So I don't know what are doing the other 1000, but it's 3 lines of code, really. So then you can say, OK, let's do it better. Let's be clever, no? Because in that way, by default, you are trying a lot of things. We are trying probably a lot of things you don't know, you don't want to try, because come on, you are expert data scientist. You know what do you want to use, no? More or less. So you can specify in that dictionary, OK, I want you, I don't know if, OK, that doesn't, but more or less, you can see what is there. I'm just saying, OK, this parameter, I'll fix it. I want you to use the XGBoost, no, the random forest classifier and the XGBoost classifier. I want you to choose one of them or use a combination of these two with that parameters, because I know that are the best parameter ever for that solution. But I don't know which preprocessor you want to use. So you can specify some preprocessors, feature selector with the parameters you want to try. So that's nice, because you can use in all the stage of your data modeling. You can use it first for knowing what is the best approach. Okay, I don't have clear if I should use linear models or I should use trees or what I want to use. Okay, you can do a data cleaning, preprocessing, and try only the models. And it will give you at least some hints about what is what you have to do. Or you know exactly the model, but you don't know which parameter you are going to use. That is something common. You can use the grid search, for instance, for that. But you can do it in a clever way using that for doing it in a generative programming way. Or you know the model you want to do, and you want to try some preprocessors, some things. No? So it can help you to give you some hints at the start when you don't know what to do, and it can help you to tune at the end the last parameters that you want to optimize. So it's also considered like the data science assistant, no? Recently, like 10 days ago or something like that, Airbnb posted that blog I recommend you. It's very important, because they say that they use the automated machine learning for improve the way that they do the data science. So they use it as in the ways that I told, in for giving some hints about the data and for give or get the best parameters. So thank you very much. Here you have the slides. Here you have the GitHub repo with I did a Jupyter notebook, so you can see all the examples with some explanations. Here you have a QR code that is the GitHub repo. So thank you very much. Some questions?
I have a couple of questions.
Yeah.
The first one is, if you increase the generation parameter, it will increase the accuracy of the model. You put there 5, Josh.
Of course, that is something that helps, but it's going to need more time. Also, the population size is important because if you increase the population size, you can reduce the number of generations because probably you are going to try more things, but you want the genetic program work for you, no? So probably you want also more generations. That depends on the time you have. That are basic examples, so I use 50. By default, are 100-100. But 100-100 with training that are small data sets is about 8 hours, something like that. So also is in that laptop. It's not, if you have a better hardware, probably it's going to be better for you. Anyways, you are going to have a progress. If you are trying to wait, you just can interrupt. It will give you the best pipeline. If you stop the optimizing, it's not going to you are not going to lose the problem. If even you can use a parameter that is in a parameter in the teapot that is warm start, that means that you can use the findings in one run in the next one. So you can use this exactly the same object for doing further generations, and that is going to help to optimize. Also, you can have the problem of the overfitting. So you are doing a pipeline that fits exactly in that data set. Okay, you can use cross-validation, but we are doing meta-optimization. So I noticed that you can have some overfitting.
Okay, thank you. And the second one is, mm-hmm. is combining in assembly models or is trying separately?
Mm-hmm. No, it try to combine them. For instance, here you can see it using a rich CV, a rich ElasticNet, and XGB regressor, for instance. So it's using the voting classifier for combining them.
Okay, but you need to specify this one.
No. By default, it's going to try. So imagine the huge number of possibilities. For that is why we want to use genetic programming. And also, we want you to specify the best config that you can, because you have some knowledge that the program doesn't know about the data, and you can specify it.
Thank you, and congrats for the talk.
Thank you. More question?
Well, I have a question. Is there mm-hmm. an easy way, say that you have 20 machines on a closet somewhere, to make a teapot use them in parallel for the...
Okay. Teapot is in development. Okay. So at the moment, you can use parallelization in the same machine. Teapot is using... behind of teapot is DEEP for generating programming. The DEEP use or can use SCOPE. DEEP is a distributed evolutionary algorithm library. So, in theory, will be possible, but it's not possible at the moment.
So, if we are interested in doing that, we can contribute.
Exactly.
Well, if there are no more questions, thank you. Really interesting talk.
Thank you very much.